So I think, sir, we are already on.
No. He has okay, to get the adjustments okay. for recording.
Okay, no problem.
Okay, good evening, everyone. We are live now. We can start.
Paresh.
Thank you.
Over to you, Dr. Paresh.
I think...
Mr. Paresh?
Hey, he has joined, sir. He joined.
He's there. We are talking to him.
He joined, but he's lost, I suppose.
He is not there now. Dr. Paresh?
Not here, sir.
I will call him.
He must have lost the connection, sir.
I'll just call.
Ashok, the mainstreaming is on?
Yes.
Yes, it is on. It is on.
Dr. Paresh has got disconnected, so he said he is just going to join.
You can start the proceedings, sir. Rajagopal, sir.
One minute only. Okay, we'll do this much.
Yes, joined, sir. He's joining.
Joined.
Paresh, sir, is joining.
I don't see him.
But is there, sir? Joined, sir.
Joined, okay.
Paresh, sir, unmute yourself. Unmute,
yeah,
sir,
yeah, yeah. Am I audible now?
Yes, sir. You're audible?
You're audible.
Sorry for the delay. However, I got disconnected. Anyway, I think my video has also stopped. I start the video again. Good evening. I welcome you all to the PG program for the pediatric cases. And it is my pleasure to welcome you all. Our chairman, Dr. Raj Gopalan, Dr. Vrisha Madhuri, the faculty members, Dr. Hitesh Shah, and Sandeep Patwardhan, the faculty members, and all my PG committee members. I now request the coordinators to start the meeting. Dr. Uday and Dr. Rajesh, please.
Good evening, all. We must thank the, Ashok Sham and Vijilani for the, the opportunity they are giving us to host these meetings. I think we'll start, straight away. The first talk is by Dr. Hitesh Shah from Manipal, and he's going to talk on Jinnu Varam. Dr. Hitesh Shah, please.
Yeah.
Yes, you start.
Good evening, sir. Whether my screen is visible?
Yes, visible.
Visible. Sir, full screen, kariye, sir. Do it full screen.
Yes, I'm putting the full screen.
All our faculty need no introduction whatsoever, so I'm going away with that formality.
Okay, good evening, you all. Thank you very much for the IOA to give me the opportunity to share the knowledge on the Jinnu Varam. For the postgraduate, the Jinnu Varam and valgum is commonly kept cases in exam. So I will go through this case and the important points on the history, examination, how to arrive at the diagnosis, how to investigate the case of the Genuvaram, what are the management strategy, what are the various options to treat the case of the Genuvaram. Because it was given the talk on the Genuvaram, I will restrict my talk on the Genuvaram, not about Genuvalgam. So any case, the start with the careful history, followed by the clinical examination. What is required in the history, the age of the child, the age of onset of the deformity. As we are all aware, there is a physiological Genuvaram and the pathological Genuvaram. It is important to differentiate between the angular deformity of knee is whether it's physiological or a pathological. A less than 2-year-old child present with the bilateral symmetrical deformity, it would be a physiological Genuvaram. If the onset of deformity is less than 2 years, most likely to be a physiological. If it is beyond the 2 years, it would be a pathological. So the most important history point of view that we need to ask the age of the child and age of onset of deformity, but it doesn't rule out the pathological cause is less than 2 years. Something like a rickets can present less than 2 years, and another important differential is a Blount disease that can also present at less than 2 years. But if the child present more than 2 years and deformity onset is beyond the 2 years, it would be a pathological cause. The important Another important history point is whether the deformity is progressive or whether it's a static. The progressive is always pathological, and that gives idea the growth plate involvement or the uncontrolled metabolic disorder. The static or regressive deformity might be a physiological, or the static deformity may be related to trauma and malunion. Another important point for the history, whether the deformity is unilateral or bilateral. It's a bilateral symmetrical deformity would be physiological, while unilateral or asymmetrical bilateral deformity would be a pathological characteristic. In unilateral deformity, one of the differential diagnoses would be Blount's or the local causes like trauma, tumor, or infection. So whenever there is the child present with the angular deformity of the knee joint, always ask the preceding history of trauma, infection, or a tumor. Most important aspect in the child with the Genuvaram is the family history, like some disease like the achondroplasia, like skeletal dysplasia, or the hypophosphatemic rickets would run in family. Similarly, the hereditary multiple exostosis would be also present as a autosomal dominant cases. So another important aspect, which angular deformity would be present in a family, that is also important. I will not go further in a history because this would be commonly kept as a short case, but these are the important points on the history, and directly go to the examination. From the examination point of view, it is very important to know about the systemic and general examination from head to toe, and why it is necessary to check the child as a whole, whether the child is suffering from any systemic disease or generalized dysplasia or the metabolic bone disease. These are the very important clues for in general examination, whether the child has got the rickets or the skeletal dysplasia, because these are the two important aspects of the differential diagnosis in pathological Genuvaram. So if it is possible, always measure about the height, whether it is the child is of short stature or not, whether the child has got any ligamentous laxity. It is very common to have in valgum, but again in varum, if the child walks with any walking thrust, lateral collateral laxity would be there, or the medial collateral laxity would be there, associated with laxity or not. Head, whether it's a frontal bossing, that is also type in a rickets or like a chondroplasia. Always check the spine and trunk and chest wall to say whether rickettic rosary, the gross features of nutritional rickets. Though in India, we need to see still many cases of the nutritional rickets. The one of the important differential diagnosis for Genuvaram would be a rickets, whether the nutritional or a non-nutritional rickets. Examine the upper limb, the case of the hereditary multiple exostosis would be associated with the shortening of the upper limb. Examine the upper limb as a whole. And as I said, whether it is a stature is abnormal, then check about the upper segment and lower segment ratio, whether it is in proportionate or disproportionate. For the postgraduate, it is important to know up to the age of the 10 years, the upper segment would be a longer, and after 10 years, at the age of 10 years, it would be equal, and more than 10 years, the lower segment would be longer. So if it is the depends on the age of the child, when you measure whether it is upper segment and lower segment is normal, whether it is a child has got any systemic features of the skeletal dysplasia or rickets, like the rickettic rosary, bidding of the ribs, protuberant abdomen, or the frontal bossing would be present, or like a skeletal dysplasia, like the pectus carinatum, excavatum, or there would be shortening of the different parts of the limb. Another important aspect is the obesity, and one of the disease in genuvarum is the Blount's disease. It would be associated with the obesity. These are the important points to look in general examination. Going with the local examination, the most of the people will start with the gait. Sometimes they may present with the gait, or at end of the examination, they do the gait examination. But whenever it is possible, examine the child and walking. So this, what we are talking about the child, it is the presented with a bilateral deformity, is a non-progressive in nature, but it remained static after 4 years of age. And when the child is walking like that, you can describe that the varus thrust is present and the foot progression angle is inward. That is the intoeing is grossly present. So in case of the genuvarum, many times we may find out the waddling gait, and that would be associated because of the mechanical axis would be deviated. Looking at the patient and what to check in the look. Whenever you see the child, we need to check the child into the gait and a foot progression angle, and check about the attitude from the side, front, and back, whether the attitude of the thigh, and always check the child from the three plane, coronal plane, sagittal plane, and horizontal plane. And what needs to check on the look, whether how much is the intercondylar distance in standing and supine. Always check in a standing position and supine position. Why? Because in a standing position, deformity will be increased because of the functional status of the child, where the intermalar distance would be not affected, but the intercondylar distance would be more because of the lateral collateral laxity. So always examine the child in a standing position and supine position, and check about the lateral thigh and leg angle. Many times it will be asked, what is a femoral tibial angle or tibio femoral angle or lateral thigh leg angle? It will give you idea about the deformity severity, and see about the long axis of the limb. Whenever you see about long axis of the limb, you can clinically take the about the ESS and second toe and find out whether it is mechanical axis is deviated medially, it would be case of the genuvarum. If it is mechanical axis is deviated laterally, it would be case of the genuvalgum. This is very important in case of the windsweep deformity. If the child present with the bilateral symmetrical genuvarum, it is very obvious to have mechanical axis deviation is medially. But whenever there is a windsweep deformity, one side is varum and one side is valgum, then it is very important to know how is the long axis of the limb, whether it's inwards or outward. Then one of the most important points for the postgraduate is the looking at the site of the deformity. That is very, very popular among the postgraduate examiners. That is called as the flexion test. What is a flexion knee test? Whenever the deformity would be checked in supine position and deformity would check in the knee flexion, and deformity disappears, that means it is the deformity component is from the femoral component. If doesn't disappear, that means deformity component comes from the tibial component. If it comes half, doesn't disappear completely, but it reduces, that means it is from the both. So if you see the same child and this is in flexion, if you see the intercondylar distance in supine position, like a before slide, and if you see now, the intercondylar distance is reduced, but doesn't completely disappear in this child. Means this child has got the component of the both femoral component as well as the tibial component. As I said that we need to check in a coronal and sagittal and torsional. Well, it was very obvious. We discussed genu valgum and varum in coronal plane. Another is the sagittal plane, whether the thigh is touching the cord or and the leg is touching the cord, whether it is sagittal bone is associated with flexion deformity. And the third plane is the torsional deformity. We can check in the prone position and see about the thigh foot angle. Normal thigh foot angle would be 20 degree external rotation. But if the thigh foot angle is towards the midline, that means in this child, it will be having associated with the internal tibial torsion. So many of the deformity would be sometimes uniplanar deformity, sometimes biplanar deformity, sometimes triplanar deformity. Commonest example with the biplanar deformity genu varum with internal tibial torsion is Blount's disease. So what need to fill in the local examination, temperature and tenderness. And the most of the children will be having no tenderness, but if there is a tenderness would be present, always check at the joint line. And if it is joint line tenderness would be present, that may be dealing with the joint disease rather than having with the bony component of the deformity. Check the level of fibula, patella and popliteal fossa, whether it is abnormal or normal. Again, you can rule out about like cases of juvenile idiopathic arthritis. Important aspect to check about the patellar tracking. That is very important in case of the genu valgum rather than genu varum. But again, severity of the medial condyle loss. Patient presented with the severe genu varum, the patella would be tracked medially. Most of the case very common in genu valgum, patella would be dislocated or subluxated laterally. Check about the other epiphyses and thorax as I included in the journal examination. Another important point to check about the cover test, covering the distal part of the tibia and check whether the alignment of the femur and proximal tibia is in valgum or not. If it is proximal tibia is in valgum, that is causing the negative cover test as is shown. That is common in physiological. While if you see on the right side, the thigh foot, it is the proximal tibia is in varus, that is positive and it just shows that the tibial component is arising from proximal of tibia. It is very one of the causes of Blount's disease. Again, I said in the thigh foot angle, we can check and the thigh and foot, the child has got the 45 degree of internal tibial torsion on the both side. Coming to the next clinical examination, movements, the most important component of the clinical examination is movement, whether it's restricted movement of the knee joint. But it is not only important to check only the knee joint range of motion, we need to always check the hip joint and ankle joint, one joint above and one joint below, because most of the deformity of knee joint may be secondary to the compensatory, the hip joint and ankle joint. But coming to this test, we need to say about the knee joint. Same time, stability of the knee joint should be checked. Like a lateral collateral would be lax in case of the severe genu varum, medial collateral would be lax in case of genu valgum. What we need to measure, the limb length discrepancy is associated with the true limb length discrepancy or not. Commonest is in Blount's disease, the limb length discrepancy would be present with the shortening. Intercondylar distance, it is important for prognosis as well as the follow-up, whether it is getting more or less. The knee joint examination, always check. Same times distal neurovascular. Again, it will be common in case of the hereditary multiple exostosis where it is associated with the bony swelling on the fibula. It would be associated with the lateral popliteal nerve palsy. And if it is missed during the clinical examination, then consequences would be poor in case of the exam as well as in clinical practice. So lastly, we can have the what is the clinical diagnosis. If this child presented like that at the 4.5 year bilateral symmetrical deformity, it arises from the both femur and tibia, it would be associated with internal tibial torsion. And clinically, we can say it is arise from femur and tibia associated with internal tibial torsion. For that, the student can say it would be differential diagnosis is rickets or hypophosphatemic rickets or a skeletal dysplasia, or broadly they can say it may be metabolic bone disease or a skeletal dysplasia. The common question, why it is not physiological? Because the age of onset is late. It will be associated with generalized features. And it was associated with ligamentous laxity with a gross deformity at 4.5 years of age. So what are the points favoring for the rickets? If it is the patient present with the nutritional rickets, again may present, or hypophosphate rickets present with the short stature, it may be proportionate in nature. There is the generalized features of rickets would be present in case of rickets. If there's skeletal dysplasia, if it is associated with disproportionate short stature, and there is no sign of active rickets. Important points for the rickets. Sometimes the examiner may ask whether it's a nutritional rickets or a non-nutritional rickets or hypophosphate rickets. The weakness would be very common in case of the nutritional rickets, while the hypophosphate rickets, the weakness of the muscle would not be common in that case. So how will you investigate this child? The commonest answer is the radiograph and blood investigation, battery of investigation to rule out the metabolic bone disease, including calcium, phosphorus, alkaline phosphatase, the renal function test, vitamin D, and ABG if it is necessary, and PTG, PTH, that would be reserved after the investigation of calcium phosphorus. But the most common investigation needed is the radiology to confirm the diagnosis, to know about the site and severity of deformity, and formulate the treatment plan. Coming to this child, when you say about the suspect about the skeletal dysplasia, we need to do about the skeletal survey. We took about skeletal survey and the X-ray looks grossly normal. There is no sign of the rickets. So this child would be having with a skeletal dysplasia. We can have in a skeletal. The difference between pathological and physiological genuvarum, when there is the physiological genuvarum, there would not be any bony changes would be there. And the deformity would be related with the proximal and distal femur as well as proximal and tibial component. It would not be only a single cause of the deformity in case of the physiological genuvarum. So next question would be there, how do you manage this patient? The management depends on whether it is physiological or pathological, always depends on the etiology of the child, the age of the child, growth remaining, the plane of deformity, site of deformity, and complication. The treatment option, when we say about observation, bracing, treatment of cause, this is a broad principle, a theoretical point, but in practical exam, the examiner will be interested, how would you manage this patient? So would you observe it is going to correct the deformity? The answer is no, because it's a pathological deformity. So it's not a good option to observe this child. Whether you do the bracing, because there is a collateral laxity, its severity is much more, the bracing is not a good option for that. Treatment of the cause, if it is a case of the skeletal dysplasia, you cannot treat like the cause for that is not going to change anything. So the option remains with the hemiepiphysiodesis and osteotomy. So the most important aspect in the hemiepiphysiodesis, it's a growth modulation. So indication, ideal indication for the growth modulation would be uniplanar deformity, either the coronal plane deformity or a sagittal plane, whether it is in one plane, in the mild to moderate deformity, and the most important growth left would be more than 2 years. It would not be skeletally mature. The physis should be open. The relative contraindication, it's a physiological deformity or the more than one plane would be involved, or is only rotational plane deformity, growth modulation doesn't work, or the child is at the skeletal maturity. The most important points for growth modulation to work is the immature child. If the child attained menarche or the growth plate is fused, the growth maturation doesn't work. Again, whenever there is a complete physial bar or the closed physis, the growth modulation doesn't work. So in that cases, there would be contraindication for the growth modulation. What should be done for this case? We need to take about long leg X-ray and plan about where is the deformity. The cora is in femur and the tibia. Again, it's an immature child. So child was treated with the hemiepiphysiodesis and it is getting it better in a follow-up. Similar cases, that's the child has got severe varum and child was presented with, this is the case of the hypophosphate rickets. The child which is presented at 4.5 years was the case of the skeletal dysplasia. This is case of the rickets. It is treated with the phosphorus oral supplementation as well as the growth modulation in follow-up. The child has got the excellent correction and the growth, the hemiepiphysiodesis, the both plates and screw has been removed and maintained in follow-up in a long run. But those cases to be followed till skeletal maturity. One more case with the complex one side valgum and one side varum, like a winged stiff deformity, mechanical axis in medially and laterally treated with the growth modulation medially on right side, laterally on the left side. And in 12 months time, the both deformity got corrected. Then one last case, the child presented near the maturity, 16-year-old patient with the severe deformity with hypopalsmoid rickets. Those cases near the maturity, the growth modulation doesn't work, where you need to do about osteotomy of the femur and tibia, and it gets a correction for that. You can see the mechanical axis deviation got corrected at the final follow-up. So in conclusion, the angular deformity of knee, particular genuvarum, should be evaluated for physiological and pathological cause. Diagnosis of angular deformity must be done before embarking of treatment, like particular rickets, nutritional rickets, and hypopalsmoid rickets, because medical management comes before the surgical management. Treatment depends on the cause, severity, and the age. Age is the most important factor. If the child is skeletal mature, the growth modulation doesn't work. If it is older patient, always require the osteotomy. After the assessing the deformity, see how much growth would be behind and left behind, how much is deformity at the skeletal maturity, and the deformity correction can be done with the growth modulation or osteotomy. Thank you.
Hello. Yeah, Dr. Hitesh, unshare, please.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. I think quite exhaustive talk, you know, on genuvarum, you know, so many things to be covered. So many causes and treatment point of view also, there are so many things, you know. Dr. Uday, any question in the chat box?
I don't see, because I have to log in from the audience channel. Yeah, I'm in the faculty channel. I don't see any questions here. I think there is no question
in the chat box.
I am checking. So far, no questions.
One question from me, that is, what is that paradox fraction test? That is one thing I want to clarify from you. And then there's an article from the Gautam Menon regarding this fallacies of knee fraction test. Just to clarify, if you want to clarify at the end of the second talk, sir, or you not to clarify now?
Yeah. If we are behind the time, then we'll go for the second talk.
We can do that, sir. Better, sir. Okay. Sir.
Yeah. We'll have question at the end of the second talk, I suppose.
Yes. Sandeep sir, I think you can go ahead with your talk.
Okay. Thank you, sir. So thank you very much, Dr. Professor Rajgopalan, Dr. Rajesh, Dr. Uday Kumar, and Dr. Paresh for inviting me here on this prestigious forum. And I'm happy to share the screen with Risha ma'am and Hitesh. And today, I think I have a very small and very brief talk. I have to talk about cubitus valgus, which is a really short case, which most of the PGs will get in the exam. Most of the times, the PGs would get a malunited supracondylar with cubitus varus. So whenever the PGs will see an elbow case, at the back of their mind, you should think only of four conditions. That is what I believe. In the short case, one is cubitus varus with a gunstock deformity. Second, cubitus valgus. Third, you have a stiff elbow because of post-trauma, post-infection, or tuberculosis or inflammatory conditions. So a stiff elbow, and finally a neglected and untreated dislocated elbow, probably. These are the only four kind cases that PGs would encounter. So that they should be really, really prepared as to what questions are going to come their way and be very precise and to the point. And I think I will just stick to cubitus valgus, because the only and commonest cause of that is a non-union of the lateral condyle of the humerus. And we'll try to give you some concepts and some examination tips. So first thing you should know is, why does a non-union lateral condyle come to you? What do they present with? And they will present to you with only three things. First is deformity, which is pretty obvious. A cubitus valgus, which means an increase in the carrying angle. Second, they could come to you with a tardy ulnar nerve palsy, which means a slowly evolving weakness and flexion deformity of the little finger, which they might complain of without even realizing they have an additional elbow problem which is causing this. The third is instability. An elbow which is grossly destroyed and unstable because of a non-union, which has become painful as well as unstable. And finally, it is some pain. So what is the story behind a non-union of the lateral condyle? It is always his story. Okay, when you present history, it is actually his story. You must find out what was the kind of trauma that the child had. Was it a significant trauma or was it a trivial trauma? And post-trauma, what treatment was taken? Because a non-union of the lateral condyle usually will not happen with a type 3 lateral condyle, which is completely rotated. If he goes to an orthopedic surgeon, I am sure none of the orthopedic surgeons will miss a rotated displaced type 3 condyle. And none of them will advise non-surgical treatment. It will be open reduced, put back into position, and it's very likely to give you a good function. So the non-unions really don't happen because of type 3, contrary to what you think. It is the type 1 and the type 2 where the cartilage hinge is broken and slowly they are given a slab or a plaster or some local treatment by massage is done. And after 1 week, 10 days, 15 days, slowly synovial fluid starts leaking into that gap and the extensors will pull the fragment away. And then it goes into a non-union and it becomes relatively painless and usually it's a slow progressive deformity and you forget about it. The function usually is decent. Because it is decent, they don't report to you very early. So typically in orthopedics, there is a formula where you have look, feel, move and measure. Okay, anytime you see a short case, quickly you must look, feel, move and measure. What do you look for? You look for increased carrying angle, that is cubitus valgus. What will you feel? You will feel thickening on the lateral pillar, instability of the fragment, and you feel for the ulnar nerve. What will you look on movement? Apparently, you feel it is full range of motion. But if you bring the hand into correct axis, you will unmask a 20-degree flexion deformity. Because there is an axis deviation, it appears to be completely extended. But actually, in the correct axis, there is a flexion deformity. And then you measure the three-point bony relation, which all of you know. You will mark the tip of the olecranon, the medial epicondyle, and the lateral. And then there will be an increase in the lateral side when you have a non-union of the lateral condyle. And distal neurovascular, you will get a high ulnar palsy. So you must examine these 4 points and distal deficit. Why are they neglected? Because they are asymptomatic, so-called asymptomatic. And I think asymptomatic is because Indian patients are quite tolerant and even Indian surgeons are quite tolerant. They would not afford a treatment to something which can cause problems in the future. So what are the effects of a non-union on the lateral side of the elbow? It causes a weak elbow because when they lift weights, the extensors are attached to that fragment and there is always some play and pull and they always feel a sense of weakness when they lift heavy weights. There will be pain, there will be instability, the deformity may be progressive. When it progressive deformity will cause ulnar nerve stretching and collateral stretching, which is not treatable unless you stabilize the lateral column. Then why are you scared of treating it? Because most of us are worried that, oh, apparently there is a good range of motion. If I fix it, I will cause stiffness. And second, whether I will cause AVN. Okay, so these are the two problems which you should understand where they come from and what can be done about it. So this historic paper in 1975, Jacob and Fowles, they wrote that all patients treated after 3 weeks lost range of motion of average 34 degrees. And they said AVN and premature fascial closure was very common. So this put a sort of a fear of God into most people and nobody wanted to treat a lateral condyle delayed presentation or non-union. Till very recently. AVN depends on poor dissection technique because you try to get an anatomic reduction and you strip off all the muscles on the lateral condyle. That is not true. The fibrosis may be intra-articular and the course of blood supply is what you should know. Where does it come from? So Harrelson proved that the vessels which supply the lateral condyle actually penetrate through a small posterior non-articular area. So as long as your dissection is anterior and not posterior on the lateral column, there is no reason for you to be causing AVN. And second, in an established non-Indian, there is no reason to dissect intra-articular, just stabilize the lateral column so that you prevent pain, prevent instability, and you will retain a good range of motion. So what is the natural history? If you look at this paper from Japan by Nakamura, he has put lateral condyle non-union into two groups. One is a progressive debilitating, disabling disease where there is a progressive deformity. Second is a non-union with a gap which has pain, but it does not deform too much and is stable in good position. Flynn and his co-workers have even termed a delayed presentation up to 20 weeks as a non-union. So how do you define a non-union if the fracture is not united between 12 to 20 weeks? And they say the cutoff is 16 weeks. So if you want to avoid AVN, they say that if you see a gap on the lateral side, you can just put a percutaneous screw. This is a typical scenario where you see a six-year-old boy who was initially treated with just a plaster, thinking this is an innocuous fracture. And as I said, the type 3 will be fixed and this will be ignored. And this went on to a non-union. And you can see that gap there and migration of the fragment. But this, even at 12 weeks to 20 weeks, need not be open reduced. You just put a percutaneous screw and an in situ stabilization will result in an excellent consolidation of the lateral pillar, which prevents further progression and all such problems. So this is a case where you are having the physis, which is open, and a fragment which is in good position. The principle here will be lateral pillar stabilization. You do not need to open, you do not need to dissect inside the joint, you do not need to worry about AVN because you are going to just put a percutaneous screw to stabilize the non-union on the lateral pillar and you just roughen or you do some local scraping on the lateral side which stimulates new bone formation and it is called pillar stabilization. There is no reason to do intra-articular dissection. Okay. So fractures can be stabilized with minimal extra-articular dissection and a combination of a screw. Again, another paper by Kim, who said that at a mean age of 5.1 years and a 5-month delayed presentation, minimum curettage of fibrous tissue and in situ screw fixation. 16 cases, all of them united without any AVN and good range of motion. The second thing which you need to understand is if there is an deformity, you add an osteotomy. Okay, so there is a definition of how much you need to correct. So if there is a gap which is big, then you may use a bone graft. So on the lateral pillar, you can put an extra articular bone graft and in situ stabilization and get a decent result. Another paper again from Japan where they had a non-union which was as old as 12 years. So 12-year-old non-unions. They had a few cases and they showed that 6 patients extra articular dissection with bone graft and stabilization, only 7-degree loss of motion. Okay, and still they get a good result. So you shouldn't really worry about not achieving union or causing AVN if you do it correctly. So it's always preferable to repair the non-union rather than leave it alone. And it has been proved by multiple papers. What about the osteotomy? So we were talking about a deformity, right? Cubitus valgus is also a deformity. So if the valgus exceeds 30 degrees with a tardial nanopalsy, you can get a deformity correction by a supracondylar Milch osteotomy. So what you can do is for a non-union like this, stabilize the lateral column, do a supracondylar osteotomy, stabilize the medial column. You need not dissect into the joint as you can see here, even if that remains with fibrous tissue, what happens is they retain excellent range of motion, get deformity correction and do very, very well. This is a 10-year-old boy with a 3-year-old non-union. You can see the fragment atrophied and progressive cubitus valgus stabilized by a plate on the medial side for the osteotomy and K-wires and some extra articular graft for the lateral pillar. And that is how it healed with excellent consolidation and full range of motion with no deformity. Ulnar neuropathy, if it is there, if you have a tardy ulnar palsy, you can always add an anterior transposition as needed, coupled with osteotomy. If it is not having any deficit or neuropathy, then you can just rely on the deformity correction, which will give you sufficient relaxation of the nerve. So let me summarize. This is a very common case. The only clinical findings you need to know are increase on the lateral side between the tip of olecranon and lateral epicondyle, a progressive deformity, which is valgus, a tardy ulnar nerve palsy, tenderness or mobility of the fragment with a decent range of motion, with unmasking of a 20 degree deformity if you correct the axis deviation. Easily repairable non-unions, anatomic repairs, in situ fixation up to 16 weeks can easily be done. Don't dissect too much. If it is progressive and disabling, you can do a non-anatomic repair with or without a graft depending on the gap. Add an osteotomy if it is 30 degrees or more of valgus and consider ulnar nerve transposition. Thank you very much.
Rajesh?
Yeah, sir. Yeah. I was muted. Very nice talk by Sandeep as usually, you know. It's a pleasure to listen to him every time. You learn a few things. Dr. Sandeep?
Yes, sir.
I think there are any question in the chat box, sir?
I'm just checking.
I can just see.
I think there is one.
There's one question is there.
No online audience as yet. Chamshul Hoda.
Okay, Sandeep, we start with you only.
Okay.
Can I ask you one or few questions, you know?
Yeah.
When you are saying, you know, grafting, you know, you are putting the graft on the lateral side only?
Yes, on the pillar, sir.
Even if there is a large intra-articular gap,
yes, you are putting it on the gap. You don't need to do anything for the gap.
Okay.
Only lateral column should be stabilized and reconstructed to prevent further deformation and instability. The intra-articular part will have some fibrosis, but it's like two rollers. The elbow is like two rollers. You just need lateral column stability to prevent the drift. Otherwise, if you dissect too much inside, you may end up with AVN and stiffness. So better not to do touch there.
And when you are saying, you know, scrap it, you know, the lateral pillar, it is through the percutaneous technique. Before you put in the screw, you scrap it.
Yeah, you can just roughen that with a small percutaneous, put a periosteum and peel off. There will be some callus reaction. You can just peel it off like an OP flap and then put a percutaneous screw and stabilize. For where there is no gap, they do very well. And the duration of non-union should be less than 6 months.
So it should be less than 6 months, right?
Yeah.
And
so
again,
it's in
you
good
know,
position.
Okay, fine.
It's in good position. Yeah.
Again, you know, the old age question, if it is asymptomatic, should we operate or not?
So that's what I said. Define asymptomatic. It's tolerant.
Patient having no pain, you know, no functional deficit. Yeah. So what should we do?
Because we know that it doesn't heal and causes problems later, and a very simple procedure can cure him, you should offer treatment in form of a percutaneous screw.
But if it is displaced, then we should go ahead with the open reduction also?
So that's what I'm saying. If you are operating in within the first 3 months, that is 12 weeks to 16 weeks, if you go with anterior dissection, don't dissect too much posteriorly, you can still do an open reduction. The longer it goes beyond 20 weeks to 6 months, in situ fixation with lateral scraping. Beyond 1 year, when there is a gap, fibrous tissue with a deformity, you do a fibrous tissue excision, some bone graft and screw stabilization, and then a supracondyle or osteotomy for deformity correction. Don't go for anatomic dissection there.
Right. You will end up more AVN or whatever.
Correct. So you correct the deformity, stabilize the pillar and do ulnar nerve transposition.
That's great.
And one question from the students, Sandeep.
Yes.
And can we comment on the carrying angle when the patient cannot extend and supinate the forearm? Extend
so that's
the elbow
what,
fully.
Yeah.
And so cannot supinate, then can we comment on the carrying angle?
So normally in a fibrous non-Indian of cubitus valgus, there will be a so-called full range of motion. The smart student will say that there is an axis deviation. When I unmask it, there is a 20 degree flexion deformity. Otherwise, what they say is cubitus valgus with full extension is actually the exaggerated carrying angle. It goes there because it cannot stay in the center.
Then one more question, sir, from the something about the tardy ulnar palsy and cubitus varus deformity. So though the topic is not cubitus varus, just I want a clarification from you. Tardy ulnar palsy and cubitus varus deformity.
It has been reported because of teethering or cubital tunnel syndrome, excessive pressure because of varus. So it's a very, so I guess this question, if the student is asked, he is doing very well. He shouldn't be worried about passing, at least.
No, it's not for passing.
It does happen. Yes, it has been reported.
But some examiners may ask this question. Of the recent discussions in some of the webinars, I came across this question. That's sir.
Yes.
Today, if I can interrupt.
Yes.
This question can be because in the earlier days, we used to teach them only cubitus valgus causing ulnar palsy. In
yes,
the
sir.
Later, I entered post graduation, then that changed. People used to talk about the cubital tunnel syndrome. So that
yes,
was
sir.
The way. So, but we still used to tell the PGs, don't tell. But today, I think that has changed.
Yeah.
They can definitely tell, like you said, it's a totally different cause.
Nowadays, examiners also attend webinars and are smart.
Very true, Sandeep.
Otherwise, no examiner used to go and read.
Sir, this webinar is really enlightened. Because I never miss a positive webinar, sir.
Yes, these webinars are not only for students,
yeah,
mostly for faculty. That also is very, very important. Education,
yes,
of
bad, which is bad news for students.
Sandeep, I have one question.
Yes, sir.
In the earlier days, again, it was very naturally all these, particularly the atlocondyle non-union was very high in JIPMA when I was PG, because most of the fractures were treated by the indigenous method and
yes,
they do not know the importance of this. So people
yes,
used to come with the cubitus valgus with tardy ulnar palsy. Today today they come cosmetic. My question is, if both are there,
yes,
along with the correction, you do an anterior transposition,
yes,
or
if I find that there is clawing, I will do a neurolysis and anterior transposition with the osteotomy. If it's just a deformity, but no, they are saying they are getting some funny feeling, but there is no clawing. It's just irritation, but no established palsy. I will just do a correction of deformity.
Great. Any other clarification from the faculty? Any questions to Dr. Sandeep from the faculty?
The question to Hitesh, sir.
Yeah,
this
no,
something on
yes,
this
yes,
that fallacies of knee flexion. Just I want some clarification from you.
Yeah, yeah. That is actually Dr. Vinod Gautam has published a good article. The importance of the fallacy of the knee flexion. It has been traditionally taught that whenever we do flexion and if deformity disappears, it is the femur, and whenever the deformity persists, it is from tibia.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
What is the fallacy? If there is a deformity arising from proximal tibia and if patients rotate the hip joint internally or externally, particularly in case of genu valgum, they external rotate the hip joint, then deformity disappears. Then we can say clinically it is from femur, but actually it is from tibia. It is common in Ellis 1 Creutzfeldt syndrome where it is deformity is from proximal tibia. Similarly, in case of the genu varum, like in a Blount's disease, the patient can internal rotate the hip joint, the deformity disappears, and then we examiner and postgraduate can say it is because of the femoral component, but that is not true. To overcome that fallacy, what is required when we flex the knee joint, make sure there would not be any rotation of the hip joint. So it has been described also, they have also described and mentioned you can hold the medial and lateral condyle while flexing the knee joint. If it is rotation is there, just rotation. And if it is rotating, if you stop the rotation, we can know is this from femur or tibia.
Yes.
That thank is a policy and a solution.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Because there's so much of discussion went on recent some of the our clinical groups also. That's why I wanted the clarification from you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Dr. Hitesh, when we talk of intercondylar distance, you know, how much should be the normal and no, it is it, anything to do with the age, you know, at a particular age, this should be the intercondylar distance?
No, in case of the physiological genuvarum, up to the 8 to 10 centimeters is considered as normal. So the most of the people can take it up to 10 centimeters normal, but depends on the age also. It is not that if the 10 years old present with the 10 centimeter, it may not be the physiological.
That is.
So yeah. You need to consider the age as well as the intercondylar.
If I can add something here, Rajesh.
Yes, sir.
So what I was taught, or if I remember correctly, is that 4 inches at 4 years. Okay. If a deformity 4 inches is 10 centimeters. Yeah. What they say is that physiologically this much cannot regress just by growth. Some intervention will be needed. We don't know what is normal, but we definitely know what is abnormal.
Right.
More than 4 inches at 4 years does not regress spontaneously.
Can I have a word on that?
Yes, sir.
This particular question has been a thing which we had a controversy in the examination last week also. Because one thing is like just now what Sandeep said, we can't call it normal, we can call it acceptable.
Yeah.
The really speaking, if you take there's no problem at all, then both the condyle and malleole must touch each other in the ideal situation. But whatever be the cause of physiological genuvarum, there is a varum, the condylar distance goes. But what we say is that this much is acceptable. I don't know. Like you said, if you ask me what is exactly normal, I have no idea. But what is acceptable, beyond which I need to correct, where I have to be worried, that is what is clear, is what I understand. In adults, it's different. In adults,
Vrisha ma'am wants to say something.
Yeah.
If I may add here, we did a normative study on the Indian children from, and we did not find anybody who was over 2 years old who had genuvarum in the normative study. So I think as far as Indian children go, I don't think we should consider genuvarum above the age of 2 years as normal. So that means if not even one child had in that whole thing, that means we crossed the 95th percentile. So I'm actually very unhappy after 2 years to consider any genuvarum as physiological undisproven otherwise. I'd like to rule out everything on that.
Good.
And then Hitesh ji, from the question to Hitesh. So before this growth modulation, we used to do corrective osteotomy serious part of the years. But yeah. Now the current recommendations are only nearing the skeletal maturity, osteotomy.
Yeah.
So now is there any role for osteotomies before skeletal maturity?
Yes, if it is the multiplanar deformity, if it is a complex deformity, if it is associated with rotational deformity, if it is the cause may be related to the complete the physis fusion, because like growth plate fusion would be more than 50% while physial bar excision is not possible, then those cases will require with severity deformity, because growth modulation can correct up to some extent, because severe deformity, again, near the adolescent or age group, that may require, or it depends on the disease, like some of the sick physis with the hypophosphatemic rickets or the some skeletal dysplasia or dysostosis or the Morquio syndrome, where deformity is quite severe and the growth remaining very less, those cases may require about the osteotomy. But by and large, for the postgraduate, if they say the growth modulation, it is well accepted for them.
Because we are going to have the examination system 7, sir, in our state, AP.
Okay.
Exams are going. Definitely, we are going to keep a cubitus varicus and cubitus varus cases. Okay. I think this is going to definitely benefit our postgraduates who are taking exams.
Yeah, yeah.
We have already corrected cases of genovargum and cubitus varus and vargus. Okay. Thank you so much, Itesh and Sandeep sir, for this is excellent talks.
So we go ahead with our last talk, sir. Dr. Vrisha, you log in, please.
Yeah. Vrisha, madam, are you ready, madam?
Your turn.
Yeah, I'll just share the screen now.
Yeah.
Sorry. Just give me a minute.
Yeah, no problem. Take your time.
Is it shared now?
Yeah, yes, it's shared now.
So I would like to thank the IOEPG committee for inviting me. I would like to take this topic, slip capital femoral epiphysis, as a case presentation, because I find that when I ask questions from the postgraduates and even fellows, I find that knowledge is sometimes lacking even in the very basic management of the slip capital femoral epiphysis. Partly because this condition is fairly uncommon and not everybody gets the chance to see all forms of treatment in this. So I would just present a sort of a hypothetical case and take up the question and answers that are usually asked. So this will be a long hip case. So there'll be a lot of importance in the history. And this particular patient that I'm presenting is a 13-year-old overweight boy with history of right hip pain for last 3 months, with groin ache and radiation to thigh and knee, difficulty in walking and sitting. And this started when he tripped and fell down on his way to school. He was able to walk after that and has been walking with a limp since then. Pain has sort of decreased and is minimal now. So what am I thinking of now? Something strikes me straight away when I hear this. The age is adolescent boy, but there are only 4 or 5 conditions present in the adolescent boys. So then Scoofy and late birthy seem likely, with the history of trauma, mild trauma, minimal trauma, and the fact that he is obese points me more towards the slip capital femoral epiphysis. So I would do a little more work upon that, and I've looked for ask for history of medical problems such as thyroid, adrenogenital, hyperpituitarism, any treatment with things like growth hormone. And because Scoofy also presents besides endocrine problems with vitamin D deficiency, and it can be a manifestation of metabolic disorders. So we would like to also ask about the renal problems, any form of resistant rickets, and also the exposure to sunlight and the vitamin D and the calcium intake. So because similar problems can be there with avascular necrosis, I'll also ask for history of steroid treatment. And also post-trauma infection is possible. So to look for ask for history suggestive of low-grade infection, as well as for any old history of either trauma or infection, because they can also sometimes present for the first time in the older age group. Other joints, opposite hip, large joints and spine, of course, we should ask for the history of this to complete our treatment. So what is the slipped capital femoral epiphysis that I'm thinking of? It's a atraumatic separation of the epiphysis at the proximal femoral physeal plate. And it is common during the pubertal growth plate and usually leads to medial and dorsal displacement of femoral head. Can also displace in the reverse direction. And when that happens, it's called a valgus slip. So if the examiner at this stage says, is it a slipped capital femoral epiphysis, in which direction, you will have to clearly define which way it is slipping. So then the fact that in the history, he shows recovery with no treatment, and they almost become painless now slowly. So it rules out most forms of arthritis. There's no history of steroids in this child. So that AVN is ruled out now, more or less. And history of hormonal treatment or hormonal disorders needs to be got. It's not there. Pain is gone, but outgrowing of the limb remains, which means some deformity has remained. And the difficulty in squatting suggests that the flexion may be limited in this particular child. The family history, both mother and father have obesity, both have accompanied the child. So specific etiologies that I need to look for is, again, besides in the history, also in the considering the examination when I'm examining for the contributing endocrine factors such as hypothyroidism, that is roughness of the skin, slow jerks, sometimes a palpable thyroid gland, If there's a history of growth hormone administration, that is a very likely cause of SCFE. We've seen a few. Renal osteodystrophy, so therefore look for any genuvalgum and any other causes, any other features of renal or a metabolic bone disorder. Adipose genital syndrome, that is the genital development is less and the child is obese. Primary hyperparathyroidism produces a metabolic disorder like thin. Panhypopituitarism and excess body weight, which is one of the commonest known causes. In India, we find that the vitamin D deficiency in adolescent is a very common cause of or common association of SCFE. So that is something that I will definitely ask for. There can be things like mechanical factors, which we can pick up only on the X-ray. So I just keep it in mind that when the X-ray is shown, I'll be commenting on the retroversion of the femoral neck and acetabular and any posterior inclination of the UFP in the lateral view. So radiation of the pain in this particular patient, he has described to the thigh, but it is also important that sometimes the patient have only pain around the knee and seen it number of times. So when a patient is complaining only pain around the knee, we have to think about the hip, and that is something not to be forgotten in the exam situation. It's a relatively rare condition and the males are more common. High incidence is common in the foreign countries during the early spring and fall. And the age group that we often see, it is between 7 to 18 years, bone age of about 11 to 15 for the girls and 13 to 17 for the boys. And under 10, when we see a SCFE, we always should look for associated conditions such as metabolic disease and other disorders, hormonal disorders. So on examination of this child, his gait is antalgic. He has got an antalgic limb. He's able to bear weight too, and he walked into the OPD unaided, into the examination room. The limb is shortened, like externally rotated, and lies slightly adducted in this particular moderate slip. There is restriction of abduction, flexion, and internal rotation, and there is corresponding increase in adduction, extension, and external rotation. However, there is no fixed deformity per se in this particular child. There's shortening, which is just about like 1.5 to 2 centimeter, and the limb goes into external rotation on flexion. This might be because of the cam impingement that happens on flexion. So on examination, there's no disturbance in ASIS level unless there's an adduction deformity and that limb has been straightened out. There's no instability on telescoping test. Trendelenburg is very difficult to sustain because he cannot weight bear on that limb by itself. And there is true shortening. I'm not going into greater details of the examination because I think most of the other things of the hip examination, students are pretty thorough with. But most of the findings are in the inspection and in the movement because not much other things will be revealed. One of the things that you can use this particular test that one can be very useful is to demonstrate hyperextension extension. Not many hip pathologies will demonstrate hyperextension. And in SCFE, you can usually demonstrate hyperextension of the involved limb. So the differential diagnosis in this particular condition will be decide slip capital femoral epiphysis could be a malunited trochanter fracture and an upper femoral physeal injury and neglected perthes. So these are the things that should be considered. Sometimes a proximal femur with fibrous dysplasia could have a path fracture and could have a similar appearance. So these things should be kept in mind. So I would, one of the things which the examiner may ask you is, you're saying SCFE, what is the difference between SCFE and type 1 injury? The difference between the SCFE and type 1 injury is the where the fracture occurs. If it occurs between the proliferative and hypertrophic layer, and that is a sort of a relatively non-traumatic injury that happens in SCFE. But in the fractured epitype and epiphyseal injury, it is to the calcified cartilage layer. So the site of these is different. So the three major pointers in the beginning in this particular case for thigh pain and external rotation gait and decrease internal rotation and abduction in an adolescent patient, which is what has put us right on the path to diagnosing SCFE, with, of course, appropriate differential diagnosis. So what are the investigations that are required? The most important investigation is radiograph to show whether what you're hypothesizing is correct. Then height and weight so that you can calculate the body mass index. Then vitamin D, calcium, phosphorus, alkaline phosphatase, and PTH for the metabolic pathway, because vitamin D from our country has been shown to be one of the very common causes or common associations with the SCFE. Then renal function and serum bicarbonate, because that also presents as renal failure with the can also present as, and low serum bicarb, this can also present as metabolic form of metabolic disturbances which present as SCFE. Then TSH and thyroid antibodies. So we have had even patients as old as 29-year-old who have thyroid antibodies presenting as, actually even at the age of 29, they have open physis and slipping their physis because they have thyroid antibodies from a very early age and they have not closed their physis. Serum lipid profile, because of the obesity and associations, assessment for adrenogenital and pituitary hormones if clinically indicated. So the next question that, when you're starting to give your diagnosis of SCFE, one wants to know what kind of SCFE it is. So you should be able to say whether it is acute or chronic and acute on chronic. So it's more than 2 weeks and then it is chronic, and acute on chronic is same as chronic, but with sudden deterioration and difficulty in walking, inability to walk. So that is Leunig's classification. Low risk classification is expected, and you should be able to say stable slip and unstable slip. Stable if they walk in, whether with or without crutches, with or without weight bearing into the room, and unstable if they are they're brought into a wheelchair and they're not able to walk with or without crutches. So the third class, if so, you should be able to say whether the slip is stable, this particular child is stable and chronic. Then the third classification will be morphological, that is mild, moderate or severe. And this one has, we need a radiographs to show it. So we'll talk about it as we go to the radiograph. So it is basically 30 degree, 30 to 60 degree and greater than 60 degree. And it is done by decreasing the normal side angle from the a line, which is at right angle to the epiphyseal line in this patient, and the line from the femur. So between that, you subtract that amount of the normal side from the other side. If both sides are involved, then you subtract 10 degrees from the angle and you get your Southwick slip angle. Another classification is by Jacob, which is just mild, moderate, severe. Slight difference here because it is, here it is one third to half, and severe is more than half. Remember in the other anatomical classification, the Southwick is 30, 30 to 60 and more than 60. So be careful when you say defining the severe type. So then the next question examiner is going to ask you when he sees the x-rays, show us some radiological signs. And the three easiest to show signs are blanch sign of steel, clean line, and decreased femoral head height. So here I will show you all of these. So you can see the femoral head height on the right and the left. So you can see that the left side is decreased, okay? And then you look at the physis, and you can see the physis looks widened on the left side again. So that is the blanch sign. And then you draw this line and you can see that line is cutting across the physis, epiphysis, part of the epiphysis lateral on the right side, but on the left side, whole of the epiphysis lies medial to the line. Another important investigation is bone scan and F16 PET CT, which a candidate should always talk about because it shows whether there is any ischemia of the femoral head, especially if the patient is coming acutely. But even otherwise, if you're planning to undertake a surgery which is could damage the blood supply potentially, we need to do this F16 PET CT or bone scan so that we can tell the candidate and also take preventive steps if you already see ischemia in the femoral head. So again, I expect the candidate to say that he will look evaluate the ischemia. So now how do we manage? So in SCFE, you are trying to attain an epiphysiodesis. So even though premature arrest or arrest of the physis is considered as a complication, but that is also the aim of the treatment. The reason is if we don't have epiphysiodesis, we cannot prevent further slip. Then the second is to avoid complications, mainly avascular necrosis and chondrolysis, and of course other complications like infections, etc. And the third is to minimize head deformity to prevent femoroacetabular impingement and osteoarthritis. And that is something which is sort of gaining little more importance now than it did before. Before we were happy if you could just pin the head dead in the center and you thought you were okay. Now more is expected, and that more is to prevent femoroacetabular impingement. For a Postgraduate student, I expect only one answer for them to give, and that is, what will they do? They will do a gentle close reduction and do an in-situ screw fixation. If they say that, I would definitely think that they pass, because if they say anything else before they say this, they may be in a little bit of problems. And then the examiner may ask you, then what will you do with all the deformity you have? You've got external rotation deformity and so many other can't flex. Will you correct that? That won't be corrected. So if we want to correct that, as a second stage, you can do an intertrochanteric flexion, valgization, and rotation osteotomy to correct that. And that would actually partly take care of the impingement also. What about the opposite hip? Because the opposite hip can be involved in very high percentage, because many people think that the scoopy is a, since it's a systemic disease, so it can, opposite hip is always at risk. Some indications for prophylactic fixation of the contralateral hip that the candidate has to mention is the younger patient, metabolic or endocrine disease. And if you think that you might lose them to follow up because they can slip further, so then if reliable follow up is not possible, better to pin it. And if the slope of the physis is greater than 20 degree, then again, the chances of the slipping is higher. This is in the lateral view. You check the slope of the physis and it slopes posteriorly, then you have a chance that you might slip further. So this is another recently added indication. So there are some controversies, especially in unstable stiffy. Should you do it immediately? Candidate should say urgent is better than the emergent or elective, especially if the patient comes very early. So as soon as possible. Gentle close reduction is always better than having the thing accidentally getting reduced. A joint decompression in the acute stages, yes. When if you get an acute skiffy or acute on chronic, yes, this may help. And one screw is better because very difficult to get two screws without causing a chondrolysis. So I think the candidate should say one screw. Yes, if acute, I would like to do joint decompression. I would prefer a gentle close reduction and I will try and do as soon as possible, but without taking any risk. I will still have a competent person, but I will try and do it urgently, especially in the acute stages. So in-situ pinning is the answer that we expect for all stable slips and for all the mild slips. And in fact, for a postgraduate, we expect them to say in-situ pinning all the time as their first choice. So this is the in-situ pinning. The aim of the in-situ pinning is to get the at least 3 to 4 at least screws across, threads across the physis. We want the thread to be right in the middle, and screw which is for larger children maybe 7.8 mm screw, but otherwise at least the 6.5 screw for the smaller children. So basically, for the technique of the screw, what we need them to say is that you will try and aim for your entry point, because they do ask often how will you put the screw. So you have to say the entry point is a little more proximal and little more anterior, and the K-wire is always directed at the center of the head and not at the center of the neck. And then you have to make sure that you're not penetrating, and this can be confirmed after you put the screw by injecting the dye to look for screw penetration. And then secondly, you can also check the relation of the implant to head outline rotation. So you rotate the hip to full internal and external rotation, and see that the screw tip goes away from the epiphyseal outline and comes back. If it keeps going away and doesn't come back, that means you still cannot be sure that you're not inside, that you're not outside. One of the things which has recently been gaining popularity, and I expect at least a fellowship level candidate to be able to say, is with very low avian rates, only about 5%, an unstable skiffy, which would otherwise have a bad results, can be reduced by PARS technique. That is, you do a capsulotomy, do a slight open partial reduction using your finger, and do the pinning. So that way you get a better position than you would get if you were not to, if you were just to do a close pinning. So this improves the pinning rate, and it also probably decompresses the intracapsular pressure. And this has been shown to be good. One of the other things you can do, and it is done at least, is to, when you're doing the in-situ pinning, is to, especially to avoid a second stage surgery for the FAI, you can do the in-situ pinning and then just make an open anterior capsulotomy, and you can do a osteoplasty because this is visible, that anterolateral bump, and as you can see in this picture, and you can remove the bump. So you have done both at the same time. So the, if the candidate is now doing well, if he's doing okay, they will probably stop at this stage and say, you can go. But if he's doing well, they'll say, what other techniques? And that is the time to bring out and talk about other techniques available are surgical dislocation and modified drill procedure for unstable slips. That is something that can be used. Or a second stage after pinning, you can do an osteoplasty with relative neck lengthening intracantic transfer that will decrease the impingement. And the third technique that they can mention is the corrective osteotomies to correct rotational and as well as valgization and create and to do and the varus and the extension deformity. So to create these three problems. So so surgical dislocation and realignment, you wonder whether there's any indication for that. But sometimes when the head is completely slipped off like this, and even you already know that the blood supply is not available there when you do the F60 PET CT, then you realize that if you leave it like this, he will both have arthritis and AVN. So you can avoid this at least by getting as quick an epiphysodesis as possible and reposition it gently and get your head back in position. And I'll show you how, though you know that this is going to be having AVN, you can still do well. So surgical dislocation and realignment may be required in extremely severe slip, which you cannot otherwise reduce. And the secondary procedures such as subtrochanteric valgus flexion rotation osteotomy by the Southwick and Imhausers, they have low AVN risk. Whereas other subcapital wedge osteotomies are also described, but they have a high risk, so would not suggest it. But osteoplasty for FAI as a secondary procedure is fairly safe. It does not cause AVN. And if skills are available, that is something that can be done, or the patient can be sent to somebody who knows how to do it. So this is a classical done osteotomy, which is subcapital, which is quite risky and should be done only by experts. And base of the neck, which is by Kramer and Barmada, again, very risky osteotomy. But the intertrochanteric osteotomy by Southwick and Imhausers, which are quite safe. So this is just to show a 1 year later, a severe chronic slip, this patient is actually united and already has got a very severe deformity. And you can actually use standard available proximal femoral osteotomy plate and get the correction. It's quite nice. I've just shown this long film because there is a limb length discrepancy that can be corrected at the same time because this patient is almost 14, 15 and you can do an epiphysodesis to achieve that on the opposite side. This is another patient which demonstrates a safe way to get the rid of the impingement. This is a 1 year post-pinning. Patient has got impingement laterally. You can see this is the 45 degree done view. And you can see that anteriorly it is impinging. So this can be, and also here again, you can see anterior CE angle in the false profile view again is very large. So this can be, you can, when you look at the femoral head, you can see that the head is damaged. And it's actually the part of it is quite, is this is the part which is impinging. So this can be corrected and also the trochanter can be brought down at the same time. So this is something as a secondary procedure can be described, but not, can we don't expect the candidate to say as a primary procedure. This is something that can be done and you can achieve a spherical head. So what is the, if the examiner asked me, what is your pros and cons for the capital realignment procedure? I would say that capital realignment procedure has a high AVN rate, 23% in the very best series that is there from the USA, 37% complication rate, requires a very well-trained surgeon experienced in this procedure and does well only when you do it fairly early. Okay, and it is not to be used for stable slips. Whereas stable slips with single screw in situ fixation is probably the best technique to use. In unstable slip, probably the better technique to use is a gentle reduction and decompression and internal fixation as seen in the PARS technique. So then the examiner may ask, what are the chondrolysis? What are the complications and how you deal with it? So we need to say premature physeal closure infections and screw breakage. These are the complications which can happen, screw nail breakage, especially if you use very thin screw and you use it in not in the central position, or if the patient is very obese and weight bears early and the fixation is inadequate. But the ones that everybody's worried about is chondrolysis and AVN. So you should straight away first say chondrolysis and AVN. So the rate of chondrolysis can be very high, up to 50%, mostly associated with pin penetration, can also happen in SCOFI due to spica cast, and can also happen when there is impingement. So don't think it's only pin penetration. Spica cast and impingement can also cause it. And we should mention it that these are the known causes. It can also happen following other procedures such as osteotomies. Now, other complication is avascular necrosis, and this can happen both. This can happen in mostly in unstable SCFI. It's more likely because stable SCFI has a very, very low incidence of this complication. That's why people suggest that stable SCFI, we don't go in for Dunn's procedure, because you are introducing a chance of developing AVN. So avascular, see here in this particular child, it's almost fully slipped off, and avascularity was recorded both pre and per-op in the theater. So we started pamidronate. We actually went in to do Dunn because that's the only way to reposition this head properly. And then we started the child on pamidronate. And you can see at 1 year, avascular necrosis is seen, but no head is collapsing. And then at 2.5 years post-op, no collapse has happened. So something that you can take preemptive stuff, it's not something, avascular necrosis is not something that we have to just wait for it to happen and feel sorry, but you can take preemptive steps to correct it. So the focus, as far as the candidate is concerned, is don't miss the diagnosis. One of the easiest diagnoses to pick up in the exam. You can't go wrong and you can't do badly in this particular case. Always look for associated causes and describe them well. So by just number them and say, I look for this, I look for this, I look for this, and no endocrine, and point out obesity or any of the obvious thing. Calculate the BMI if you know, if you remember the formula. Then present the type and the stability of the slip when you describe the diagnosis. So to just don't say slipped capital femoral epiphysis. Say it's a chronic, stable slipped capital femoral epiphysis. You can't tell obviously how much the slip is. That has to be seen on the X-ray. Then suggest the safe treatment. Always say in situ because they're not going to get an unstable. So in exam, say in situ screw fixation. And emphasize on the pin penetration in AVN. And therefore, also the reason why you choose one single screw fixation for SCOFI. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, great talk, Dr. Varisha. You have touched all important points in a short span of time, you know. If any questions from the faculty, any clarifications? Yes, Dr. Uday.
Madam, I have a very few basic questions on behalf of the students, madam. The one is, can we comment on the gait? The patient cannot walk without any assistance. The child cannot walk with assistance. That is one point, madam. Can we say assisted gait or aided gait? Or can we comment on the gait when the patient cannot walk without any assistance or aid?
I think if it is an aided gait, you will still know whether it is painful or not, right? And if the patient is, despite having an aid, is obviously dipping down, you will also know that whether it is, he is presenting with a short limbed or not, because he may be actually bending the opposite knee just to be able to hop forward. So just because he's aided doesn't mean that it is fully non-weight bearing gait. He may be partially or more than partially weight bearing on that limb. So I think whatever you see, you can comment. You can always comment on whether the pain is there or not. You can always comment on whether any obvious indication of a limb lengthening or limb shortening is there. That need not be removed. And the aided and unaided can be presented. So gait, unless the patient is not walking, is in the wheelchair or coming on a stretcher, can be commented on.
And another point, madam, you said that Tendenberg test cannot be done. But can we do assisted Tendenberg test in these cases?
This is a painful hip and patient will not be able to stand on this. So that is why I said Tendenberg test cannot be done.
And then,
Tendenberg test to be done, if you find that there was no abduction possible, possibly better not to again go too far, because it may be from very severe reduction to slightly less reduction, but definitely you cannot prove Tendenberg if there is already a pre-existing reduction deformity.
Then can you clarify the sectoral sign and axis deviation, madam, in this case? What is the, either both are same or the difference is there? But please clarify for the benefit of students, what is sectoral sign and what is axis deviation?
So I think here what happens is when you're flexing the hip and it starts to go into abduction, that is will be like an axis deviation. Because you're not going in the, instead of going in the straight line, you start to deviate. If there is a collapse of the head or if there's an impingement, then the limb rotates as well. So I think that probably that is, there's a difference between the impingement and there's a different, so there is an impingement added on.
But what are the, this differential restriction rotations, madam? Can we call it a sectoral sign? Extension, it is normal, it is okay. But in flexion, yeah, they are restricted.
Yeah.
Are the faculty, Itesh sir and Sandeep sir?
I don't know. I think somebody who's used to answering this, because I don't
can
know.
Can I do that? Can I answer that?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Dr. Uday, sectoral sign when there is a differential rotation. Whereas axis deviation is only one plane. We are talking about deviation or flexion of the hip. We are not doing any other movement. Now both, the what is the inference? The head has lost its sphericity, the loss of contour of the head. That is the impression. But for a axis deviation, it is not only the contour. A fixed deformity also will cause it. Suppose there's a fixed rotation deformity, it also will still be there. The sectoral sign is a differential rotation. Both are different.
Okay.
Yeah, then, I agree with Dr. Rajagopalan, sir. The sectoral sign, basically, when there is a difference in rotation, many examiner will... So, whenever there is a sectoral sign or difference in the rotation, they will say it may be possible to have a Perthes disease. And the axis deviation, the many of the examiner will expect to say in case of the slip capital femoral epiphysis, there is the axis deviation is present. When the examiner tries to flex the hip, it doesn't go on opposite side, it goes on the same side, an external rotation. That is axis deviation.
Exactly like cubitus valgus, what I was saying. When you try to extend the elbow, actually there is a flexion deformity, but it goes in valgus.
Yes.
If I may add here, almost all hip pathologies, when you flex them, they go into, if there is a hip pathology, it will not go in the same axis. It will always deviate. So I don't know whether, I hear this actually in the exam a lot, but I don't 100% see the relevance of this particular test. Because there will be pathology in the hip. When you flex it, it will go, it will change its axis. If there is a pathology in the hip.
But usually what we standard teach the students, suppose there is a differential restriction rotations in flexion and extension, then it indicates there is a head disease. Because usually in the hip, we discuss the disease of the joint and disease of the head. When there is a head is deformed, usually we get this type of differential restriction rotations. That's what my opinion, sir. Itesh sir and Sandeep sir.
Yeah, you are right. Then see, when we say the madam is telling any hip pathology.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Rusha, carry on.
No, what you are describing is like there is an impingement. There is an abnormality in the head shape. So there is an impingement. So your internal rotation is restricted. So it can happen in Scoofy. It can also happen in Perthes. It can happen anywhere where an impingement starts.
And one more question, madam. And yes, sir.
Hitesh was telling something.
Sir, Hitesh.
Hitesh, continue and then.
You know,
Hitesh, please continue.
Yeah, madam was telling is correct. The any hip pathology range of motion is restricted. And what is your understanding? Say anything is the difference in the rotation, internal and external rotation, as well as the hip, ipsilateral hip goes in external rotation, that shows the intra-articular hip pathology or the head involvement. So for that, we need to have a differential diagnosis. It cannot say definitely slip capital femoral epiphysis or healed or deformed Perthes disease. That may be possibility. Student can say, I can keep the different hip pathology as a differential diagnosis. Depends on the journal examination, depends on the age of presentation, age of onset. if it is child is there in first decade, it may be Perthes, maybe there in the adolescent or older, it may be slip capital. Or if it is bilateral involvement with the other problem like a pseudorheumatoid or the skeletal dysplasia. Depends on the age of presentation, onset, and presentation of the other clinical features, we can say the differential diagnosis.
Because in this long case discussion, always this sectoral sign comes into discussion, sir. Itesha, sir. So
yeah,
always
it is, examiner. The most of the examiner can say on the sectoral sign, but the best answer to the sectoral sign is there. Whenever the differential rotation more than 20 degree in flexion and extension, then they can say either the head collapse or head deformation or possibly the intra-articular pathology or incongruency, you can say. For that, the smart student can say, I will keep the differential diagnosis, differential hip pathology.
Yes.
Okay, rather than sticking with one pathology.
And they can also use the word impingement here, because this is what now,
yes,
the current literature doesn't talk about this anymore. They just talk about impingement in such a situation.
Yes, ma'am. And one more question, madam. This is, we say in squiffy, there is a restriction of abduction interrotation, but Simon, there is a exaggerated interrotation and exaggerated adduction. Can we say, can the student say that combined arc of motion is normal in this case?
It's not normal. There is maybe an exaggeration of external rotation adduction, but the combined arc may not be same, because there is often a element of impingement happening here, which may limit the arc. So it's not always the same. But one thing I think which differentiates this from all other hip pathology is the presence of extension. So more extension, so if you catch both the hip and legs from the back with the patient prone and lift it up, you can very easily demonstrate a hyperextension on the affected side. And I think that is something which you don't see in anywhere else that easily. So that is a very sure sign in my mind that I use to when I'm unclear about other pathologies in SCUFI.
So the combined arc is definitely affected.
Yeah, it is. It is affected. It is not always. It's not actually combined arc is not normal. It is less than normal still.
And lastly, one question, madam. What is the role of hip arthroscopy in managing SCIFI, madam? That's about.
Yeah.
Is there any really any role for management by arthroscopy?
Yeah, I think it's one of the few conditions where your impingement area is exactly very well defined. So instead of doing an open osteoplasty and doing the very big thing, so in this situation, if your trochanter is not very riding very high and you don't need to bring it down, a very small impingement can very easily be taken care of, because the junction of the abnormal neck and the head segment is well defined. You can do a arthroscopy to remove that. It's a very nice indication for using a hip arthroscopy.
Like often many of the young surgeons are trained in hip arthroscopy. They claim that it can be managed with arthroscopy.
Yeah, I think what
is the extent of indications? I want to clarify
so
from you.
Mild one, where you don't need to do a trochanteric distalization. And as far as the impingement part, osteoplasty part is concerned, you can take care of it with hip arthroscopy.
Okay, man. Thank you, madam. Thank you.
Rajesh.
Sir, few questions here to Dr. Varisha. Madam, is there any term like idiopathic cause of SCIFI? Suppose we roll out everything, you know, can we say it is idiopathic, like so many diseases in orthopedics?
I think it's not necessary to say idiopathic, because unless you have gone through all the retroversion, the various angles, assisted radiologically, clinically, I wouldn't like anyone to say that. I don't think it's necessary to say that.
Great. Is there any role of conservative treatment in some mild variety?
So if you have a mild SCIFI and your epiphysis is not fused, this mild SCIFI can then progress on to become moderate and then become severe. So if you have it has started slipping, it's better to fuse that or at least fix it. And if it's a very young child also, still you'll want to fix it so that it doesn't slip further. Because definitely a mild SCIFI is a reason for it to slip further.
Great. Suppose we don't have the facility for bone scan and PET scan, you know, should we go for the surgery or refer somewhere else?
stable SCIFI you can always pin as long as we understand the principles of pinning. And that's a safe procedure once you get used to it. So I think stable SCIFI is something that I don't think you should make them run around for 2-3 months and in the process get them to displace. I think if it's an unstable SCIFI, then I think you are on a little slippery wicket because you may have AVN, which will be attributed no matter what you do to you. So then I think it's better to have the bone scan or the PET CT, show that it is this thing. Tell the parents, you can still do the in situ pinning, but then also take preventive actions because you know that the AVN will be coming. So can you prevent the collapse? So avoid the collapse.
Great. When we are doing pinning, ma'am, suppose we penetrated the joint, you know, we have seen through the dye. What is the bailout then?
You actually just withdraw it. It's not like something which is still going to have a chondrolysis just because you penetrated once. Because so many times we penetrate with KYS when we are doing the hip screw fixation and all. So the most of the time they have shown that the actually the pin or the part of the screw is lying in the outside of the articular cartilage. That is what causes this, that constant injury. Sometimes it's not even the screw. They have shown that even the impinging part of the bone can cause a chondrolysis. And a prolonged immobilization can also cause chondrolysis. But the best thing is if your pin is going out, you have to withdraw it and change it for a shorter pin. No, don't just withdraw it because it may still go back, to change it for a shorter.
Great. Ma'am, you are telling a past technique, you know, open partial reduction. But once we are opening it, why not full reduction? Why partial?
I think the you actually, if you go and look at it, it's very difficult to, from the anterior approach for you to actually try and reduce it. That's point one. Secondly, if you try and reduce it fully, you're likely to cause a damage to the blood supply, which you cannot see. That is the reason why people started using Dunn's approach. Because you can actually see the vascular supply and protect it and take it off. So idea of the PASS technique is just a very gentle reduction in an unstable SCIFI, which is still mobile, with your finger so, and while you put the pin, so that you still get a little reduction. You don't have so much of impingement and you get a safe fixation.
Great. And so, lastly, what do you mean by relative neck lengthening?
Relative neck lengthening is when you have a lot of impingement and you're actually the part of the is relative neck lengthening is basically you're trying to restore the neck. So you restore the neck because your neck becomes short. So if your neck has become short, after you do the osteoplasty, you take the trochanter down and you convert part of the, you actually lengthen the neck. Relatively.
But, yeah.
Because if you don't do it and supposing you took off a lot of the neck when you're you reduce your head, then neck becomes very short, or if the slip is quite severe, again the neck becomes very short. If that happens, the hip tends to sublux out because the total length of the neck is short, and also it becomes mechanically not a very good hip. So by doing a neck lengthening, you can improve the function of the gluteus medius.
Okay. Dr. Rajagopal sir.
Yeah, Rusha, I have one question. You know, even particularly with now with all this OSCE coming up, when the management, is it ideal is just one screw or the ideal is two screws?
One screw. One screw is one very, screw. Very difficult to even get one screw right. I think sometimes it's almost like you're struggling to make sure you get a good position for that one screw. Two screws is almost, you have to be, I don't know.
Difficult in our.
You have a very huge hips. Which are so huge that you can easily place two hips, not our hips.
Wait.
Any other comments?
Any questions in the chat box, sir?
Yeah, in the chat box, so far only the one question. After that, there is no question. No questions. I'm just saying that.
I think there's no question in the chat box, sir.
Okay. My daughter Subin has informed me that he will not be able to log in. So I will take his, join him in during the vote of thanks. First of all, what should I say? I don't usually, all the three faculty are good friends of mine. I know, I mean, that the talks have benefited me a lot because quite a few things I have forgotten or I did not know either way. but there is always something to learn, and I'm sure it will be extremely useful to the students, because believe me, I was quite surprised. I was talking to Visha the other day, and she was telling that they were not as really skippy well, whereas I would have expected them to, you know, to be lateral contact and skippy. I expect them to have more problem with Genovar, acubitus Genovar. But, you know, the three talks have been so very well clearly done. I'm sure it will benefit them. And that's our idea. How many of them log in? How many of them learn? That's not our idea. Even if we can teach one person, it's still worth it. I'm extremely thankful to all the three faculty, Hidesh, Sandeep and Prisha, for sparing their time. I know Sandeep, I think, had a meeting yesterday, or I saw the other person meeting, and there's so many unknown to me will be there. Hitesh had the last Ganga Hospital the other day, and he had one more after that in the posting. Prisha is just supposed to have one meeting before this. So she wanted to join at 7:30 as a suspect. Fortunately, it was cancelled. So I know that it is the interest to teach and done beautifully. Last time when Prisha did for his thing, she asked me, what do you put me now? Am I passing or am I failing? I'm happy she didn't ask me today, because she asked me, they do well. I don't know, because each person did well. I don't know who did better. Thanks to you all. And whether 5 people log in, 500 log in, it doesn't matter. I do plan to continue it like this. If I benefit two students, it's more than. That's not the number, doesn't count. And thank you all. And I must thank Dr. Paresh for the welcome address, and Uday and Rajesh for moderating. And in case, you know, sometime the questions come to us later, I will contact individually all three of you, the faculty. Thank you all. And most important to the delegates, to the delegates who are listening, I hope, sincerely hope that it benefited you. If you have any doubts, at any time, you can still call. And also, in case you have anything else to suggest, most of you have my number, otherwise I'll put it there. Please do contact me with whatever program you want, whatever subject you want for the rest of Sandeep, to you. Sandeep, you want to say Sandeep?
It was a wonderful experience. Thank you very much for having us.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
One more thing is, I think all the students, I just want a message to all the students. Don't think that these webinars are for the passing of your examination. That is not the correct concept. Because these days, when I was a student, when I was an assistant, and now I am a HOD in some college, the examination pattern has totally changed. And then examiners have become liberal, and everything has become so liberal. But all the posts, please remember the passing the examination is only a little hurdle in your career. So there is a more and more examination are going to come in your future, day-to-day practice, day-to-day surgeries, every time, as long as they're in an orthopedic practice. I feel that every day is an exam, every day is an exam for us, for a physician or surgeon, whoever it is, especially for surgeon who dies every day. Hitesha must be smiling. So please remember, PGs, you don't learn the subject for mere only to pass the examination. There is something more and more than passing your just MS. MS degree is only to give a license to practice, that's all. But never makes a master of orthopedics. We are all still, after 33 years of learning, I am listening, Madam Sandeep Patwardhan and Hitesha since a long time. Still, I am enthusiastic to listen to whenever a Sandeep Patwardhan sir webinar is there, Hitesha webinar is there, Madam webinar is there. I am very eagerly wait for the webinar to come. So that is the, so we are lifelong learner. That's what my message today. Thank you very much.
Very well said, Uday.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Good night, everyone.
Good night, everybody.
Good night. Good night.
Till I see you again after a few months.
Few months or 1 month, sir?
No. Pediatric after a few months.
Okay.
If I keep one more pediatric, there are others who are going to kill me.
Next year, sir. Next year.
Hopefully even more.
Okay, thank you.